Hi guys, welcome to a Brain Smart Start with me, Steph. Hope you guys had an incredible Easter weekend. Hopefully you guys enjoyed all of the Easter activities last week. I know you made a sock bunny with Miss Carolina, and you dyed some eggs and an Easter activity with Mr. Carlos and Miss Barbara. So hopefully today when we join together for our Zoom call at 12:30, today at 12:30, a Zoom call where we get to see each other. Okay, the link is on the schedule and it's on Facebook too. So hopefully when we join today at 12:30, you guys can show me your sock bunnies and activities. I know Miss Jessica also told you on Friday to just show us anything that reminded you of Easter that was in your home. Okay, so any craft, any activity, bring it. I want to see it today at 12:30. Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started with Brain Smart Start, where you know the drill. We're going to go ahead and sing our wow song. We're going to do some breathing, some stretching. We're going to practice American Sign Language. We are going to wish well our community. And we are going to focus on our commitment. And then I'll tell you the schedule for today. Does that sound good? Alrighty, let's go ahead and get started. Okay guys, let's go ahead and sing our wow song. Remember that in the part where it says high five a friend, we are high-fiving ourselves, but in the moment that you do that, think of all of your wow friends who are also just home and miss you as much as you miss them. Okay, ready? One, two, three. Wild cats, listen up, high five a friend and sing along. Wild cats, listen up, high five a friend and sing along. We are all in this together. We are wow, you and me, united and free. We are all in this together. We are wow, you and me, united and free. We are all in this together. We are wow. Ready? We are wow. I know that I've been playing a few songs every now and then that I love dancing with you guys. So I do have another song that I miss dancing with you guys. So how about we go ahead and do that? You guys want to dance? So remember, when I do these Just Dances, there are a few different characters that are dancing for you to kind of copy what they're doing. Some of them are crazy, throwing themselves on the floor, jumping. So you don't have to do that. Okay, just make sure that you are having fun to the music. Copy as many moves as you can. Some of them are really fast for me and I can't keep up, but just have fun, copy as much as you can, and just dance. It's all about having fun and just bringing energy to yourself this morning, okay? Are you ready? Guess what song I'm doing. I love this song and we love dancing it together, and there's a part at the end where they make a human bike. Do you know what song I'm talking about? Let's see if you guessed it.
Dust yourself off and back in the saddle. You're on the front line, everyone's watching. You know it's serious, we're getting closer, this isn't over. The pressure's high, you feel it. But you got it all, believe it. When you fold it up, oh, oh. And if you fold it up, eh, eh. Cause this is Africa. It's time for Africa. plan for Africa. Samina, mina, eh, eh, waka, waka, eh, eh. Samina, mina, saka, lewa, anawa, ah, ah. Samina, mina, eh, eh, waka, waka, eh, eh. Samina, mina, saka, lewa, it's time for Africa.
Try to do that bike with you guys, and I know that we're not together, but my character that I was trying to copy was the one on top, and I tried to do a squat. And are you guys doing squats with Mr. Mo? I think you are. Anyway guys, let's go ahead and do our breathing. Hopefully you guys are like me and just need it right now. Okay. So let's go ahead and get started. First things first, stop, smile, take a deep breath, and relax. Okay, two more times. Stop, smile, take a deep breath, and relax. Last time, let's make this one count. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna inhale a big breath, and then we're going to exhale for as long as we can. Because when we do that, that's the best way to relax, is when we are exhaling. So when we're letting the air go. So we're gonna take a deep breath, and we're gonna try to let the air go for as long as we can, okay? Stop, smile, take a deep breath. And that's as long as I can go. Hopefully you went a little bit longer than me. I think the more you do it, maybe the longer you can last, or the bigger your breath. We'll start experimenting, but that's the best way for you to feel relaxed. So remember, whenever you're feeling a little bit anxious or a little bit stressed, take a deep breath and then just try to let it go for as long as you can, and all of your muscles relax. I know that all of us are spending a lot more time just seated on a computer or in front of an electronic, or even if it's sitting in front of your TV when you're done with your WOW virtual classroom, we're spending a lot more time seated than ever. So I want you for this whole week to just pay attention to your posture when you are seated in front of your TV or computer, iPad or phone, whatever you're using to see me right now. You want to make sure that your posture is nice and straight. Okay, so push your shoulders back. Make sure you're sitting nice and tall, because sometimes what we do is that we bring our shoulders too forward, and then it ends up hurting our back, okay? So you wanna make sure you're always seated nice and tall. And then let's just go ahead and stretch our neck right now. So you're gonna just turn it to the side. Like I always tell you, you can use your hand for some added pressure. Let's hold it there for 10 seconds. Okay, let's go ahead and do the other side. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. Go ahead and put it down. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten, and look up. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten. Now let's take it around town. Ooh, my hair. Okay, guys, hopefully that helps with your neck and your posture. Let's go ahead and roll our shoulders a little bit. Just right there where we're seated. You can twist. Twist. And don't be afraid at any point to just pause what you're looking at and do some of these just quick and easy, gentle stretches just to make sure that you're helping your back and your neck. Okay, guys, hopefully that made you feel better. I definitely know it made me feel a lot better just by doing those quick little easy steps that I did just right here, still seated. Okay, for our American Sign Language words of this week, I wanted to do house, home, family, mom, and dad. Five easy words that I think some of you, or if not all of you, already kind of know. You've definitely seen them. So I just want to make sure that you know those five words for this week. And as always, there will be a quiz on Friday. And I'm thinking maybe this week we can do the quiz on Friday on Zoom. What do you think? Okay, let me go ahead and teach you them first. How about that? So our first word is house. So this one, you want to just draw the house with your hands. So you do the little roof and then the body of it, house, roof, house. Okay. And that is house. Nice and easy. You start with your hands together, kind of like forming a little triangle. You slide them down, you're drawing the roof and then down for the body of the house. 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 Hopefully that was easy. Then home. I know you guys know home. You've definitely seen it at WOW. So what you do is that you start with your hand like this, kind of like making a little raindrop shape. You want to put your hand to your mouth and then you bring it all the way up to your temple. Home. Home. So what it is you kind of, it's where you eat and you sleep, okay? So it's home, home, home. So we got house and we have home. And our third word is family, okay? So you wanna do the letter F, which is these three fingers standing and then your pointer finger touching your thumb. So family, you'd go around town. So you go around family, family, family. So you're doing the letter F because family starts with F. And then you're doing like a circle because it's just showing family. It's the people closest to you, right? So although I'm teaching you the word mom and dad, a family is made up of a lot more people than just those two, right? You have your brother, your sister, and then you also have your family at WOW, the staff that loves you. You have the staff in your group home. You have the people in your group home that you live with. All of those people are family. Family. So far we have house, home, and family. Next one I'm going to teach you is mom. So mom is also one that you should be familiar with, but what you do is you take your hand and you touch your chin with your thumb. Mom. 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 Mommy. Mama. Mother. Mom. And then dad is also very easy. You want to go ahead and do the same thing with your hand nice and open, but instead of to your chin like you do for your mom, you're going to bring it to your forehead, and this is dad. 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 Bobby. Daddy. Father. They're all the same, okay? So just a quick review. We have home. Ooh, I messed up. We have house, house, home, home, family, family, mom, and dad. Again, this is house. I know I made a mistake, but this is house. Home. You are home. And me too. Our no birthdays for today. It was Gary's birthday on Saturday, so we sang him happy birthday on Friday. But Gary, if you're watching, we hope you had an incredible birthday. I know there are two people whose birthday it is this week. I know you guys are looking forward to it, and we'll be singing you happy birthday when it's your birthday this week. So make sure you keep tuning in, and it's gonna be a good one. So last week we took time to wish well all of the staff working in hospitals, the doctors, the nurses, therapists, and practitioners. So this week we want to go ahead and wish well all of our first responders. So our firefighters, the policemen. So just take a moment, and you know how we do it. We put our hands on our heart, close your eyes. Take a moment and think of everyone that you want to wish well, anyone that you know who's a police officer, who's a paramedic, firefighter, and let's go ahead and wish them well. Ready? One, two, three. We wish you well. Last week, our commitment was to watch all of the videos the whole way through, because I do know a few of you maybe just watch me or kind of skim through it. So we were committed to watching the videos all the way through. Hopefully you did make that commitment. And if you did, when you come on the Zoom call today at 12:30, let me know and I'll celebrate you. But for this week, our commitment is going to be to use encouraging words. So during this time, I know all of us are scared and stressed and all of that, but we really have to focus on the positive, that we are healthy, that we're together, even if it's through technology, through my phone, through your iPad, through the laptop. So what we want to do is being focused on the positive and to use encouraging words with one another. So when we are on the Zoom call, compliment a friend. Tell them, hey, Tammy, I like how your hair looks. Hey, Marcus, your beard does look good. We can tell Victor that his face looks amazing shaved. Okay, so take a time and compliment one another. Use encouraging words. Tell them that you're so happy that they're using Zoom, that you're proud of them for doing all of the videos. And when you see your teachers on there too, take a moment and just tell them thank you for taking time to post videos just so that we can stay connected. Okay, so a thumbs up if you commit to use encouraging language this week. Also remember that the same goes for who you live with. Okay, so you want to make sure that you're helpful and encouraging in your house with anything that your parents need, your group home managers. Make sure you're someone who's being a light to wherever you are during this time. Current event, I just wanted to once again remind you guys that it is Autism Awareness Month, and I'm thinking that this Wednesday, yeah, so not tomorrow, but Wednesday, we can all wear blue when we're on our Zoom call. Can we do that? Can we all wear blue? Look through your closet, look through your laundry, make sure you have something blue to wear on Wednesday in honor of Autism Awareness Month. I'll see you there wearing blue. For our meditation today, we will be taking a quick short virtual visit to Vizcaya Museum and Gardens. It's actually something local here to Miami. We actually haven't been to, but hopefully when this is all over, we can go together. And they are currently closed just like the Wow Center is, but they're providing online resources just like we are. So we're gonna go ahead and meditate in their Lily's Pools with their Vizcaya at Home resource. Hopefully you guys can enjoy it. Brain Smart Start for today. Thank you for joining me. Right after me, you are going to have Mr. Carlos in STEM, Mr. Mo in Sports, Miss Susie in CBE, Mr. Luke for Rec Therapy. A Zoom call with this girl at 12:30. Zoom call, 12:30 with me. Make sure you log in at 12:30. The link will be on Facebook and it's also on your schedule. Okay, for us to go ahead and talk at 12:30. Don't forget. And then right after that, you will have art with Miss Carolina and then life and work skills. And after that, special topics. Love you guys so much. I hope you have an amazing wild day. See you at 12:30.
Guys, my name is Carlos, this is my small maraca, and this is a 24 strings bass solo. Sounds. Hello guys and welcome back to another class. Today, before we start, I want you to do something. I want you to close your eyes. Yes, cover your eyes. Pay attention to your surroundings. Tell me, what do you hear? Yes, today we're gonna be talking about sounds. Sounds are all around us, all the time. There are so many of them, and we call sounds by a lot of different names. For example, if you try to get somewhere early in the morning, I'm sure you're gonna get stuck in the traffic. And all those cars honking their horns at the same time, well, we call that noise. But if the sound comes from an instrument, like the one that your teacher Jessica used, well, we call that a note. And when you get a lot of notes together, we call that music. It doesn't matter what made the sound. All sounds are made the same way, through vibrations. And what is a vibration? A vibration is a rapid back and forth movement. Now, put your hand around your throat and do this. You can do it also with your fingers, right here. Do you feel it? Well, what you feel right now is your throat vibrating. That is because of the vocal cords. The vocal cords are the reason why we can talk and scream. Well, when you pass air through your throat, that makes your vocal cords vibrate back and forth, and that produces the sound. But a vibration happens so fast that it's impossible for us to see it. But thanks to special cameras that can record in slow motions, we can see the vibration happening and see how they look. Check this video. Do you see the instrument's movement and the vibration? Well, when something vibrates and it moves back and forth really fast, we can actually not see it. But it creates sounds. But there is other parts of our bodies that can actually sense the vibrations. Do you guess what parts those are? Yes, your ears. So the question is, how the sound gets from the maraca to your ears? The answer is the air. Yes, the air is all around us in this moment. That's how we breathe. And it's made out of tiny particles that we cannot see. And these particles are what carry the sound. You can think about the air as in a two-way street, the air highway. That sounds, when it vibrates through these particles, it goes and comes. But how all this happens? Well, when you make your little maraca sound, or for example, when you clap, or you play the guitar, or you play some music, you are making it vibrate very fast. And that vibration hits the particles around the air. we can think about the particles in the air as dominoes. That looks something like that. Pay attention.
When we ring a bell, we cause the metal that makes up the bell to vibrate really fast back and forth. And the vibration of the bell also shakes up the particles that make up the air around it and makes them vibrate. Then those particles run into the air particles next to them, and so on. You can also think about it like dominoes, with the vibration getting passed along from one bunch of particles in the air to the next.
And to all these vibration game, we call it a wave. Think about yourself when you play basketball with your friends and the ball goes back and forth. Well, some waves do the same thing. They travel back and forth. A sound wave is a vibrating energy that looks like a wave. Now, how can we picture this? Well, do you remember this scene?
It's the power trying to come back on.
Where's the goat?
Jurassic Park. Well, let's put the dinosaurs aside for a moment and let's concentrate on what is important for us. The first part of the scene, the 2 cups of water. Let's look it again. Do you see the water moving inside the cup of water? That is energy, and the energy, you can see it as a wave. Actually, we can do that experiments ourselves. I'll give you 2 minutes to get a couple of things. Well, actually, one thing only. Go to your kitchen, of course, ask for permission and ask for help. Okay? Go to your kitchen, get a cup, fill it with water, and come back. I'll give you 2 minutes. Go. Are you guys ready? I have a cup of water right here. And all you have to do is take your fingers like this, and you have to hit the cup of water to the side, like that. Of course, you make sure that you put the cup of water on top of the table, and you hit it like this, and you will see the wave going around the water, just like that. Do you see the waves? No, right? Well, as we said before, these vibrations cannot be seen at a glance with the human eye. But what will happen if we down the speed? Let's watch it in slow motion. Now we can see them. Do you see the water moving? It goes like this until it breaks in the center. That is a wave. Yes, like the waves that we can see in the ocean. I think that would be an easier example. But that is a wave, guys. That is how it looks. Another way to do it, it is if you take a string on both sides like this and you loosen it and pull it over and over again, you can see it. You can see how it vibrates and create waves as it moves. Something like this. Do you see the shape that the rope formed? That is exactly how a wave looks. It's like going up and down. Something like this. Waves are represented by these drops. When you speak and the sounds travel through the air, the waves are formed like this. Now, as you can see, there is a different kind of waves. And that is because we don't speak in the same way all the time, or the music, or any sound. There is sounds that are super high, and there is sounds that are super low. So, the separation between the waves, it will tell you what kind of sound it is. If the separation is not that much, just like this one, it's a high sound. If they are very separated, like this one, it's a low sound. But how is that we actually can listen to these sound waves through our ears? Well, I think this can explain us better.
Now, how do we hear those vibrations? If we could look deep inside our ears, we'd see a special little part that kind of looks like the top of a drum. When sound waves make it all the way to and into our ears, they make this part of our ear vibrate. The vibrations keep going, moving even deeper into our ear until they finally get to the spot that sends a message to our brain. And that message says, hey, we're hearing something!
Now, who's ready to do some listening exercises? Well, we're gonna play a little game named Guess the Sound. Get ready and pay attention. Let's see if you can guess all the sounds. Did you guess all the sounds? I bet you did. Okay guys, so for the next 10 minutes, this is the activity for today. I want you to go around your house and listen to the sounds. Listen to the birds, listen to some music, to your favorite songs, or create your own sounds like clapping or just hitting a little bit your table and identify them. Plus, I want you to get a paper and a pen or a pencil because I want you to draw your own sound waves. And it's gonna look just like this. I want you to complete the whole page, one by one. You're gonna get your pencil or your pen, and you're gonna go up and down, until you finish, okay? It was amazing to be with you. Enjoy the rest of your day, guys. See you next time. I wish you well. Bye.
Hello guys, welcome back to another Wild Virtual Sports and Fitness. I'm yours one and only, Coach Mo. I'm glad you guys are back for another fun and filled and exciting workout. So today we're gonna do some basketball exercises. I hope you guys are excited. It's my favorite sport, so I'm gonna get you guys fit and ready to go. We're gonna work on that core, get it right and tight. And let's go ahead and jump right in, okay? Alright guys, welcome back. Alright, so now we're gonna go ahead and get right into our warm-up. Alright, so the first warm-up we're gonna do, we're gonna go ahead and get our legs warmed up. So we're gonna stay in our same position, and we're gonna warm up our legs by marching in place, okay? So guys, we're gonna start right now, okay? Ready, begin, go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. So next thing we're gonna do is we're gonna walk in a circle, okay? In our living room, in a small circle. We're just gonna walk in a circle, slowly, okay? Let's get that heart flowing, get our blood going, and let's get active. You know Coach Mo like to get at it. Alright, so after we did that, alright, we're gonna do 10 toe touches. We're gonna touch our toes and touch the ceiling. You guys ready? Begin. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. So now we're gonna go right into it and we're gonna get into a jumping jack, okay? Let's do 10 jumping jacks. Are you guys ready? Ready, begin. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Good job, guys. So the next exercise we're gonna get into, all right, is gonna consist of spreading our legs, all right? So we're gonna spread our legs, we're gonna go down, we're gonna touch our right foot, we're gonna come up, touch our left foot, and come up. Are you guys ready? Ready, begin. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 8. 9. 10. You guys are doing amazing. So the next thing we're gonna do, guys, we're gonna take our left foot. All right, and we're gonna take our left hand. We're gonna touch our foot. We're gonna raise our right leg up and touch our toe and bring it down, okay? Are you ready? Ready, begin. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, getting kind of sloppy here, guys, 10, so don't be afraid to mess up. If you mess up, you just keep pushing through. All right, here we go. Right foot. That's 1, guys. That's 2. 3. We gotta work out that happy, that healthy snack. 4. 5. 6. 7. 8. 9 and 10. So now, guys, what we're gonna do, we're gonna take our right arm, we're gonna lift it, we're gonna lift our left leg, all right? So it's gonna look like this, and then the opposite, all right? So we're gonna do those. It's called like a mountain climber, okay? Are you ready? Ready, begin. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. You guys are doing amazing. Good job. Now we're gonna take our hands, put it on our hips. We're gonna do the washing machine. You ready? Begin. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. So now, guys, what we're gonna do is we're gonna take, pretend we got a basketball. We're gonna drop low and come up and shoot, all right? So we're gonna do that 10 times. You guys ready? Ready, begin. 1, 2, make sure you go down and touch the ground. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. All right, we're gonna do one more thing. All right, and then we're gonna get right into our water break, and we're gonna go into our exercise, all right? So we're gonna run in place. We're gonna do this for 20 seconds. Are you guys ready? Ready, begin. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, and 20. Guys are doing great. You deserve some water. Go ahead and get that water break. Make sure we stay hydrated. Keep those hands clean. All right, so I see you when you get back.
So close, despite my distance, even when I face the giants in the darkness with the lies, tell the devil that he's a lie. And even when I'm in the waiting in all of my broken places, give me faith for I am faithless, and I will not be afraid. No, I'll be okay. Even when I won, your eyes are on me, yeah, yeah. And you're never far, I wanna feel your heartbeat, heartbeat. When my faith is fading, your love will still embrace me. I know that I can make it, I can make it. When my faith is fading, your love will still embrace me. I know that I can make it, I can make it. You're with me when I walk through fire.
Alright guys, welcome back from your water break. So now today we're going to get right into our workout. Alright, today I'm going to ask you guys to make sure you take off your shoes on today's workout, okay? So I'm going to take my shoes and I'm going to put them over here to the side so I don't step on them and trip on them or anything, all right? So now we have our feet. We should have at least socks on, I would say. All right, so the first exercise we're going to do is we're going to do calf raises. All right, with this, we're going to make sure we focus on strengthening our toes, okay? So we're gonna make sure we put most of our body weight like forward, all right? As we go ahead, we do our calf raises, all right? We're gonna lean our body forward so we can put most of our weight on the front of our feet, all right? So here we go. We're gonna go ahead, we're gonna do 10 calf raises, okay? I hope you guys are ready. All right, ready, begin. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. All right, so now guys, what we're gonna do is we're gonna jump, all right, on the tip of our toes. So we're gonna be on our tiptoes and we're gonna jump just like that on our tiptoes. All right, we're gonna do that 10 times, all right? Are you guys ready? All right, we're gonna try, and also we're gonna try to do this consistently. So fast as we can, we want quick jumps, okay? All right, so here we go. Are you guys ready? Ready, begin. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. You guys are doing great. Great job. So now what we're gonna do is we're gonna take it in and to high knees. We're gonna take our knees, we're gonna lift it, we're gonna try to put our opposite elbow on our knee, okay? All right, so you guys are ready? Ready, begin. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10. You guys are doing great. So now guys, what we're gonna do is we're gonna take this right into a lunge, okay? So we're gonna take our left foot, we'll step forward, put our knee on the ground, pull it up, bring that left leg back to even. All right, take that right foot, step forward, knee on the ground, bring it up, and that's one. All right, so are you guys ready? Let's go, let's get this work. Ready, begin. 1. That's 2. That's 3. That's 4. That's 5. Keep it going, guys. I know it's hard, it gets tough, but you gotta fight through. That's the only way you're gonna get better. That's 6. Seven. That's 8. You got 2 more, guys. Push through. Spinning strong, baby. Spinning strong. Woo! 9. All right, that's 10, baby. You guys are doing an amazing job out there. Keep it up. So now what we're gonna do is we're gonna get in that squat position. All right, and we're gonna try to hold it for 30 seconds, all right? Can we hold it for 30 seconds? Ready? Begin. Squat and hold it. Hey. You guys gonna feel that burn. Right now, put about 10 seconds in. You gotta fight through. Come on, guys. All right, 10 more seconds, guys. Fight through. We're almost there. 5 seconds. Fight through. Woo! Feeling that burn, baby. You guys did it. Great job. All right, so now what we're gonna do is gonna go right into 10 air squats, all right? Let's get right into it. Here we go. Spread those legs. When you're ready, begin. That's 1. That's 2. That's 3. That's 4. That's 5. That's 6. 7. That's 8. 9. And that's 10. Good job. You guys are doing an amazing job. So now what we're gonna do, guys, is we're gonna pretend we have a basketball, right, in our hand. So this is working on our balance, all right, similar to the warm-up that we did earlier. So we're gonna pretend we have a basketball, or if you do have a basketball or anything, you can get it. So for instance, look what I found. You already know what this is. It's what we about, Heat Nation, baby. So I got my pretend ball. All right, so we're gonna take our left foot, we're gonna take our ball, we're gonna go down, we're gonna touch the floor with our ball, with our right foot balanced and up in the air. So we take it here, bring it up, and shoot, pretend to shoot. All right, so we're gonna do that 10 times. And don't forget, whatever we gotta do on the left side, we gotta do on the right. Or whatever we do on the right side, we gotta do on the left. So let's go. Here we go. Ready? Ready, begin. Whoa. Oh, I almost fell. That's 1. Remember, you gotta keep that leg in, the knee in. That's 2. Here we go. That's 3. Whoa. And that's 4. Remember, this is working on our balance. Even I'm struggling with this. The more we do this together, the better we get. So we're on 4. Here we go. And that's 5. Go down. And that's 6. All right. 7. That's eight. That's nine. Woo. And that's 10. Woo. You really feel that burn in that leg. All right, so here we go. Right leg down. That's one. My right leg is a little stronger, but it's still weak. That's three. You guys are doing an amazing job. You're better than Coach Moore right now. That's four. That's five. And that's six. For those that you are having trouble, you can just do this. All right? That's seven. That's eight. That's nine. And that's 10. Remember, guys, don't forget to breathe. It's very important to breathe. You always breathe in through your nose, out through your mouth. You are correct. All right, so now what we're gonna get in next is another balance drill. So we're gonna jump on our left foot, and we're gonna hold our right foot. All right, we're gonna hold it for one, two, three, and then we're gonna jump to the other leg, hold it for three. One, two, three. All right, and then each leg, that'll be one. All right, guys. All right, so guys, are you ready for the next exercise? All right, let's go, baby. All right, so here we go. We're in the middle, and then we're gonna jump to our left leg, all right? And then we're gonna hold it for 3 seconds, jump to our right, hold it for 3 seconds, and jump back, and that will be one. All right, ready, begin. One, two, three. One, two, three. That's one. One. Two, three. One, two, three. That's two. One, two, three. One, two, three. That's three. One, two, three. One, two, three. That's four. One, two, three. One, two, three. That's five. One, two, three. One, two, three, that's six. One, two, three. One, two, three, that's seven. One, two, three. One, two, three, that's eight. One, two, three. One, two, three, that's nine. One, two, three. See, Coach Mo getting that. One, two, three, that's 10. All right, you guys, clap it up. You guys are doing amazing. So next thing we're gonna do, since we don't need the ball no more, all right, we're gonna get down into push-up position. All right, and we're gonna do a plank. All right, so we're gonna hold up on our forearms like this, and we're gonna hold it for 30 seconds. All right, so get in position. You got 10 seconds to get ready. All right, I hope you guys are ready. Ready, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Begin, hold it. Hold it up, remember your butt up, your knees off the ground, forearms on the ground, and you're holding it. And you're holding in that core. All right, keep it going. Got 15 seconds. Let's go. Keep it going, guys. You got it. All right, that's it. So now, for those of you, all right, for those of you that aren't able to do push-ups, you guys can be on your knees. For those of you that can do push-ups, I want you in push-up position. So the next thing we're gonna do and similar to that, all right? So we're gonna do, we're gonna do push-ups, okay? So we're gonna have our hands up. I'm gonna go down on our forearms and come back up on our hands, and that's one, okay? So here we go. That's another example, all right? So for those of you that can do push-ups, what you would do is, you would put your hands here, just like that, and that would be one. That's two, all right? So are you guys ready? Let's get right into it. Ready, get in position, go. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10. Great job. You guys deserve a water break. Go ahead and get some water. Come right back.
Don't rush, slow touch, brown and white. Like I go country, grab and buy. We can go bust, eye for eye. We can lose trust, white rum, fizzy pop. Where you they go, go, we they go up. Catch my vibe, let me go off. That my life trash, man it's so tough.
Alright yo, put the belly on the body, make a clutch. Tino watch, now she wanna give up. Boy got peas, now she hopping in the pod. Man a real life, sugar gal, let my forget what. When she want dark, told her meet me at the top. Switching lanes the other day, I seen her waiting for a bus. Maybe this a Moncler sweater, diesel denim. Buy another one, my pockets fat like heather. Neck froze like I don't know no better. Benzo truck, white seats and they leather. Go broke never, on my grind. She make it click like I'm Busta Rhymes. I got the juice, the sauce and all them things. I've mad twice a night with all my bling. Big Benz, I drive, I brought that thing. Any girl you want, they were my thing.
Don't rush, slow touch, brown and white. Like I go country, grab and buy. We can go bust, eye for eye. We can lose trust, white rum, fizzy pop. Where you they go, go, we they go up. Catch my vibe, let me go off. Let my trash, man it's so tough. Flood my eyes, make a whole blush. Back of the tour bus, getting cool up. D square, got them de-stressed. Got a hand wash, new racks with the old Nikes in the shoebox. Keep my stripes, no cuss. Pull up in a new plate, then she might just. She went tryna move bait when her eyes locked. New tints on a coupe, that's a head loss. Off my whites, right my rungs. Gucci my mum, why you to do your thumbs? Count my sums, this is gonna get long. Love my green, I'm tryna get strong. Tryna get on, where I'm from, it's on. Yes, man don't take no dumb threats. They see funds, they hop fence. We been up, not up. Next. Don't rush, slow touch, brown and white. Like I go country, grab and buy. We can go bust, eye for eye. We can lose trust.
Alright guys, welcome back from your water break. So now we're gonna get right back into this workout. So now again, we're gonna get down on our knees. Alright, so we're gonna get in push-up position. And we're gonna do shoulder taps, all right? So what we're gonna do is be in push-up position, tap our shoulder with our opposite hands. We're gonna do, that'll be one, and that'll be two. All right, for those of you that can't do a push-up, you can get on your knees and do the same, shoulder taps, all right? So we're gonna do 10, are you guys ready? All right, everybody in push-up position. Ready, begin. That's one. That's two. That's three. That's four. That's five. That's six. That's seven. That's eight. That's nine. That's 10. You guys are doing amazing. So now we're gonna lay down. We're gonna lay flat on our stomachs. All right, so we're gonna put our arms straight out, our feet out, and then what we're gonna do is we're gonna lift our both of our front hands, all right, and we're gonna lift both of our back feet at the same time. All right, So we're gonna do that 10 times. I'm gonna show you one more time. All right, so here we go. We're gonna do 10. These are called the Supermans. Are you ready? Ready, begin. One. You gotta hold it. Two. Three. Four. Five. Six. Seven. Eight. Nine. One more, guys. 10. Woo! That was hard. Alright, so the next exercise, last and final, you guys will need a towel. So I want you guys to go ahead and get a towel. Alright, come right back. Alright, got my towel, guys. I hope you guys got your towel. So what we're gonna do, we're just gonna take our towel, it could be any towel, doesn't matter. We're gonna take it and we're gonna fold it in half like a hot dog. Alright, fold it one more time in half like a hot dog. And then make sure it's long like this. Alright, next thing we're gonna do is we're gonna have a seat on the ground. Alright, and this is called seated calf raises, all right? So we're gonna take a towel, all right? We're gonna actually do one foot at a time. So the foot that we are doing is gonna be out, and the foot that we're not doing is gonna be tucked in. So we're gonna put a towel around the tip of our foot, all right? And we're gonna pull. The harder we pull, the more resistance we get in my calf, all right? So as I pull back towards me, I put my calf forward, and that will be one, all right? And then here we go, two, all right? So we're gonna do 10 each. Ready? Ready, begin. One. Two. Woo. Three. Four. Five. Six. Seven. 8, 9, 10. You guys are doing an amazing job. You're getting this work in today. All right, left foot on the tip. All right, you guys ready? Make sure you get a good grip there, all right? So ready, begin. One, two, three. You should feel some resistance when you pull it back in. Four, five, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. You guys are doing an amazing job. All right, and that will do it for today. All right, that will do it for today. You guys keep exercising. You guys can rewind this, do it multiple times. All right, I recommend that you do each one of these workouts we did today at least 3 times, 3 sets. I taught you guys to do that. Do 10 reps in 3 sets. All right? So until next time, I love and miss you all, and I'll see you soon.
Before we get started with our reading of The Giant Under the Snow, I'm going to give you some questions that I would like you to think about while you're listening to the book. So try to find these answers in our story so that when we're done, you can answer the questions. I know that, for instance, Jasmine is taking notes while she is watching our videos. So if you are doing something like that, as you find the answers to the questions, I encourage you to write down your answer. And I'll go over the answers at the end.
The first question is, where are Junk, Bill, and Arf going after school? The second question is it light or dark outside when Junk, Bill, and Arf leave school? Question number three, what did they discover about the disc that Junk found in the forest when she fell? Remember the mysterious disc she put in her pocket? What did they discover about that? Number four, what is the name of the museum they visit? And that one is, you might have to write that one down because it's not a common word. Number five, who shows up at the museum when they are there? And question number six, what did Junk, Bill, and Arf do when they saw this person? All right, guys, it's on. Up next, our story. Good morning and happy Monday. How is everyone today? Today we're going to be going over chapter 4, I can't believe that we're in chapter 4, yay, of our book, The Giant Under the Snow, by John Gordon. And so let's do a little bit review of what we've learned so far. So far, Miss Jonquil Winters went into the woods. She had an argument with the teacher, so she went off into the woods by herself, which is never a good idea, and she got lost. And she caused quite a commotion. Everyone was going crazy looking for her, but a lot of very strange things happened to her when she was in those woods. She fell. She found what looked like a hand made of trees. And she was chased through the woods by a dog, by a very mysterious dog. She also met in the woods Elizabeth Goodenough, and Miss Elizabeth Goodenough lives in a house behind some walls in the woods. And Elizabeth Goodenough saved Jonquil from the wolf that was chasing her by cracking an invisible whip, which Jonk could hear but could not see. What was that? Then on the way home, only Jonk and her best friend Bill could see the wolf. The next day, that wolf was still following them around, and this time the wolf was joined by a man who looked somewhat like a statue. The way they described him, they said that he didn't look like he was alive. He looked like he was very still, like he wasn't even breathing. So who is this mysterious man with the, it's not a wolf, it's a dog actually, a very big dog. It just looks like a wolf. What? Who is this man? Why is he following Jonk around? When she fell in the woods, remember, she found like a medallion made of gold and she put it in her pocket. What is that? So as the mystery deepens, Jonk and her friends, Arf and Bill, are determined to find out what this mystery is. So now they were going to go to the museum to do some research, because Jonk didn't really want to go back to the woods to see Elizabeth Goodenough, right? So let's get started with our reading of chapter 4 called Shadow in the Gallery. Ooh. Darkness had fallen when they put the school behind them. It was easy on the last day of term to get out before classes ended. They met at the gate. Every room in the building was lit and they could see people moving about under the streamers in the classrooms. In the hall, colored lights were winking on the Christmas tree. It was as though they were running away from a great house in which a ball was taking place, but they needed secrecy. Bill and Arf were on each side of Jonk, who pulled up her fur collar and buried her nose in it. They hurried, not sure what time the museum closed. They thought of the dog, and shadows made them bunch closer. At blind corners, they crossed the road to get a better view. Bushes humped in the dark gardens were like the bald dome of a stone-faced man they had seen that morning. They were glad when they were among traffic near the center of the city. Junk opened her fur collar as though the glittering Christmas chandeliers strung overhead in Gregory Street were pouring warmth on her. I thought all the time we were going to see the dog, she said. The main museum stood on a hill in the center of the city and was floodlit at night. Amber light shone on it now, and they could see the pillars of its portico from a distance. It lay directly ahead of them, but Bill crossed the road at the traffic lights by St. Gregory's Church and began to lead them up a less busy street beside it. "Where are you going?" said Arv. "The museum straight ahead." "We're not going to that one," said Bill and pressed on. "Hold on," said Arf. "You said we were." "No, I didn't. I said the Crescent." This was untrue, but he knew there would have been trouble with Arf if he had mentioned earlier that he had always intended they should begin their search in the smaller museum in the Crescent. There was trouble now. "You don't mean you're going to that heap of old junk, do you?" said Arf. Bill merely nodded and kept on walking, but now Junk objected. "I don't like the Crescent," she said. She thought of the lonely trees they were heading for and the big old house which had been converted into a museum. "It's the obvious place," said Bill. "It has lots of local stuff." "Local rubbish," said Arf. Arf's clear mind rejected the collection which, with the house which held it, had been bequeathed to the city long ago by a wealthy and eccentric man. When you bequeath something, it means you leave it to the city. But Bill felt drawn to it because it was odd. He took them deeper into the narrower streets, still arguing. The shops were smaller now and the decorations in the windows were less flamboyant than in the big stores they had left behind. And they had gone too far to turn back. Junk fell silent and Arf grumbled, but less persistently. The street sloped upwards and a biting wind blew along it. At the top, another road crossed it, and beyond this, other streets sloped down into a quiet area that was in the very heart of the city, but seemed cut off from it. The Crescent was a wide semicircle of big houses that put its arms halfway around a public garden. The center house in the curved row, and the biggest, was the museum. They came over the brow of the hill and began the descent. This was Bill's territory, an almost secret place. He led them down into it. The street lights were widely spaced and pale, stretching their necks so high they seemed more intended for lighting the cornices and upper windows than the ground. Only an occasional car came by, headlight beams rising and dipping over the cobbles as ships' bows ritz. There was nobody in sight as they entered the Crescent. They walked along it until they came to the short flight of steps leading up to the front door of the museum. At the top, they looked through the glass panels of the door. The foyer was not well lit. The walls were crammed with pictures, half of them in shadow, and at the far end, flanking the doorway into the next room, two marble statues lifted graceful arms and gazed at each other with blind eyes. Between the statues, they could see the glass cases of the main gallery. Bill looked at Junk. Her eyes were wide and very dark. "All right," he said. She nodded and turned the handle and pushed the door. Only Bill did not jump as, above them, a doorbell jangled on its spring. He reached up and stopped his hideous little dance. They stood just inside the door, waiting for somebody to come, but nobody did. Bill relaxed. If the curator had come out of his room, he would have watched them silently and sourly until they left. It had happened before. "I know the best place to try first," he said. He walked quickly through the foyer, making himself ignore the marble figures as he passed them. In the main hall, he threaded his way between the glass cases, his trainers squeaking on the polished lino, and with Junk's heels tapping rapidly to keep up with him. Halfway along the hall, he turned through an open doorway on the right, and they were in a small room with one tall window that looked out into the blackness. So if the window is looking out into the blackness, what time of day is it? They've only just gotten out of school, but remember in places like England, in the winter, when they get out of school, it's already nearly dark. Now what? Arf stood in the center of the room waiting for something worth his while to be revealed. Jonk was unhappy. It seemed pointless to be standing in the cold, still back room of the deserted museum in a forgotten corner of the city. But at least, she thought, Bill was taking it seriously. She would try to enter into his enthusiasm. She crossed to where a stone coffin rested on wood blocks beneath the window. Roman, she said, reading the label. Whoever was in here may have seen the green man. She surprised Bill. He grinned and slapped the stone. Tall cases lined the walls. There were fragments of pots, a sword rusted into little more than a flake of black metal, and some coins. I don't see how this is going to help. Arf was moving about impatiently, glancing at the exhibits without interest. If you spent a bit more time, you might see something, said Junk. She knew why Bill had brought them here. Every object in the room had been touched by hands in the past so distant that these few motionless scraps were all that remained. But she did not expect they would find anything to convince Arf. Arf, however, had found something he could understand. Some framed maps were hinged to the wall so that they could be turned like the leaves of a book. What about this? He said. He was looking at the map of the Backlands showing all the known burial mounds, the sites of ancient hamlets and religious monuments. He put his finger on the glass. That's where we were. There's the track. There's a burial mound way over to the side, but look at that bit of heath where Jock was chased. Not a thing. There was an area which, apart from the dotted line of a track, was blank. Pleased, aren't you? Said Junk. It doesn't prove anything, said Bill, and he began to turn the frames. He found a more recent map with roads and houses marked. Let's see if we can find Elizabeth Goodenough's place. He and Junk traced exactly the route the bus had taken along the track, but the green of the forest was unbroken where the house should have been. All that means, said Arf, is that the house has been built since the map was made. But it was an old house, said Junk. It was all old, very old. When she had walked through its strange garden, it had been dark, but the humped shape of the building and the warm room with the wide, low fireplace made her sure nothing about it was new. The more we go into all of this, the more there is to find out, said Bill. What do we do now? Nobody had anything to say. The room seemed dingy and neglected, useless. Isn't it quiet? Jung tried to speak normally, but her voice was almost a whisper. You can't even hear any traffic. They listened. There was a gentle sound of their own breathing, nothing else. The silence began to press on them like a trap, closing slowly. Let's go. They followed Bill into the main hall. It was a very tall room with a staircase at one end, leading to a gallery that ran around its walls. A row of lights in plain white shades hung on long cords from the high ceiling. Smaller lights shone in the gallery. They kept close together as they walked along the gangway between the double row of exhibition glasses that took up the floor space. From every wall, stuffed birds gazed at them through glass. Birds. All those eyes, thought Junk. What do they do when the lights go out? She wanted to hurry, and when Bill suddenly stopped, she pushed against him. Just a second, he said. Look at this. He bent over a glass case. I can't see, she said. Your shadow's in the way. He shifted. There were fragments of shaped stone, a few flint arrowheads, some bronze objects, and in the middle, some pieces of metal that had been placed in a row. The typed label said, fragments of a bronze ceremonial belt. The pieces were a dull reddish gold. Each one seemed complete in itself, and each was the size of a large coin, circular, but made of a continuous interwoven strip. Look at that. Bill's deep voice echoed in the hall. Arf peered over their shoulders. Exactly the same thing you found, Junk, said Bill. Not exactly, said Arf. They're smaller. Not much, said Bill. He turned to Junk. Did you bring it? He knew she had. All three had been looking at it together in school. She nodded. Let's see it then. Her hand was on it in her pocket, but she did not want to take it out. Hurry up, he said. She hesitated, biting her lip. She knew that what she had was a piece of the belt, and she did not yet want to know more. Too many things were fitting into place. If she brought the pieces together, something would lock tight and there would be no escape. The lights in the side room went out. She started and pressed back, but Bill stayed where he was. Quick, he said, the museum's closing. From somewhere below in the basement, there was a faint click. The foyer behind them went dark. Junk turned, wanting to run out, but Bill held her wrist and pushed her hand toward the glass case. Don't, she said. He relaxed his grip, but she did not snatch her hand away. It was over the glass, with her fingers crooked around the glimmering ribbons of metal. For the first time, Arf was excited. It's the buckle, he said. It completes the belt. A click from the basement and the gallery above them was in darkness. Only the well of the hall was lit. Let's call the curator, said Arf. The back of Junk's hand rested on the glass. It was directly over the belt. There was a pause. They had almost been trapped by the silence in the side room, and now they were held by the completion of the belt. The certainty that something was about to happen held them still. A final click and the last lights were gone. In the blackness, Junk's fingers tightened on the buckle until its edges bit into her hand. Bill's hand closed over hers. Together, they lifted the buckle clear of the glass. She heard him sigh. The further the buckle was from the belt, the safer she felt. We'd better get out before the curator comes to lock up, he whispered. Arf's little laugh echoed in the hall. Shh, Junk tried to quiet him. Best to make a noise, he said. If we creep about, he'll think we're thieves. Outside, a street lamp showed through the glass panels of the front door. It was too far away for any of its light to reach them. They began to feel their way towards it along the edges of the exhibition cases. Bill tried to chuckle. Arf's right, he said. If we don't make noise, we'll frighten the poor old curator out of his skin. They could hear stirrings below. The panels in the front door had a rim of frosted glass, a shadow cut into the lower edge as someone began to climb the steps from the street. Junk felt as if she had been waiting for this to happen. The others had noticed nothing. She made them stop. The shadow came up slowly, broadened until it filled the bottom pane, and then the figure came into view. A massive head on broad sloping shoulders pressed silently towards them. They could see no face, but they knew that in the dark side of the head, deep gashes of eyes were leveled in their direction. Damn. Junk was shrinking back. Bill took control. The gallery, he said, quick. They retreated into the blackness, nudged by the corners of the showcases, which seemed always to bar their way. Bill held Junk's sleeve. His foot kicked the bottom stair. Arf! Arf had become separated from them. Arf! Yes, he had missed the foot of the stairs and was wandering somewhere to their left. Here, said Bill. Arf was fumbling toward them as they heard the door handle begin to turn. Hurry, hurry, Junk urged him. She began to back up the stairs as she felt over the banisters for Arf. His coat brushed her hand as the front door bell kicked and jangled. They saw both halves of the door swing inward. A dog's feet rattled on the lino. With a hideous slowness, they climbed backwards, as though the black tide was rising at their feet. They could hear the dog running to and fro in the foyer. The front door was out of sight, but enough light came through from outside to show them the arched doorway into the hall. A shadow fell across it. They reached the top of the stairs and crouched behind the railings. Keep down, right down. Bill's voice was barely audible. They lay flat, their faces to the bars, listening to the paws, the dog in the hall below. There was no sound from the man, none, but the well of the hall seemed full of him. It was a black, aching hole in which he was gliding. He may be anywhere, perhaps climbing the stairs. His foot might at any second crush them. They did not breathe. The dog stopped. There was complete silence, and then, like a cruel wind creaking the door of an abandoned house, came a laugh. It gibbered in the hall, finding its way through the cracks in the air to rake their hair with bony fingers and tug at their scalp. They felt themselves being drawn out of hiding by it, and they clung to the bars while it swept over them. Then suddenly, the sound withdrew, sucked away to a single point below. There was a crash of breaking glass, a hasty scrabbling, the rush of dog's feet out of the hall and across the foyer, then silence. Lights came on and they heard running feet in the basement. Arf stood up. We'll get blamed for this, he said. Bill and Junk lay where they were, still clutching the bars. Get up! We'll get blamed for this, he said. Bill and Junk lay there. They began to obey him, but it was too late. The curator was running across the foyer. Arf crouched. The curator was pale-faced but businesslike. He walked from case to case until he saw the broken one. He looked in it, touched nothing, turned, and moved quickly out of the hall. He's gone to telephone, said Arf. Now's our chance. He had taken charge. Neither Bill nor Junk seemed to care if they were caught by the curator. They knew they were already trapped by something else. Interesting. So what do you think Bill and Junk feel that they are trapped by? Could it be that they're trapped by the mystery of what's going on? And why did Junk have the buckle of a belt that was in a museum? Who is this mysterious man, and why is he following them? How did he know that they were going to be going to the Crescent Museum? All questions, I'm sure, we'll find the answer to next week when we read Chapter 5. Attached to your daily email will be a question sheet with some questions for you to answer. So, give them a go, and next week we will review your answers. Have a good day, everyone. Bye. Okay, so now it's time for the answers to our questions. Number one, where are Junk, Bill, and Arf going after school? Did you figure that out? Did you remember? They're going to a museum. And museums are great fun places. I'm a big fan of museums. I love taking you guys to museums. So maybe when we're all back together, we can go to a museum together. Doesn't that sound like fun? Number two, is it light or dark outside when Junk, Bill, and Arf leave school? The answer is, it's dark. In some parts of the world, in the winter, it gets dark very early. And so, for instance, when my husband used to go to school in Scotland, he would leave in the morning and it was dark. And by the time he got out of school, it was dark again. I'm pretty sure Barbara once told me she had the same experience. So that's where they live. They live in that same part of the world. Scotland and England and Wales are all together on the same island. Number three, what did they discover about the disc the Junk found in the forest when she fell? The answer is that it is a belt buckle from a belt that is on display at the museum. And if you remember from our outings to museums, Sometimes in museums, they have these cases that have things in them for you to look at but not touch because they're behind glass. That's where they have that belt in a case like that. Number four, what is the name of the museum that they visit? The museum is called the Crescent. Have you guys ever had a crescent roll? It looks kind of like a croissant, right? It's kind of shaped like that, like a piece of the moon. Okay, well, the reason the museum is called the Crescent is because the neighborhood that it's in is shaped like that. Number five, who shows up at the museum when they are there? The answer is, of course, their faithful followers, a big mystery, the mysterious man and his dog. What are they doing following these kids around? What could possibly be the reason? Are they good? Are they bad? That's a question for another chapter. Number six, what did Junk, Bill, and Arf do when they saw the man at the museum? When they saw him through the door of the museum, what did they do? The answer is they hid. It was easy for them to hide because all the lights at the museum had already been turned off because the museum was about to close. So they hid. Did they get away with it? Yes, they did. The man and the dog left. All right, guys, that's it for our lesson on The Giant Under the Snow, Chapter 4. I wonder what awaits our friends in Chapter 5. See you next time.
Hey everyone, welcome back to another Rec Therapy session with yours truly, Luke. I hope you guys are doing well. Again, this is recreational therapy. This is not Brain Smart Start. Again, you'll be seeing Miss Stephanie and me doing that. But right now, we're going to be doing some rec therapy, and I thought, what better way to spend this time approaching our Earth Day as, dealing with another part of the Earth, Japan, right? Japan is a very cool, very different country. They practice various things that we may not even have heard of before. And so with that being said, I'm going to go through this little book that we have here, and we're going to learn all about Japan. And so this ties into recreational therapy, because in recreational therapy, we can use being, I guess, educated or learned on different cultures to be able to be therapeutically treated. So essentially, when you look through all of these places and you see what we're going to see in this book, you can receive, I guess, some knowledge from that, and also maybe it can expand your worldview and or make, you know, everything easier to understand, in a sense. Certain things we might not understand until they're explained in a different context or in a different place. So with that being said, guys, let's go ahead and move on. All right, so welcome to Japan. This country is made up of thousands of islands, right? However, most people live on the four largest islands, which are called Hokkaido, Honshu, Kyushu, and Shikoku. Okay, so these are the four largest islands that everybody tends to live on. Mind you, like they said, there are thousands. So, you know, it's not just in those four islands, but people will live, you know, mainly in these four, okay? So more than 127 million people live in Japan. And this is the city of Kobe, actually, on the island of Honshu, okay? It's very beautiful, as you can see, very cool architecture here. And also all these buildings around, you have a ferry boat, and it's very nice, very, very nice scenery. Alright, so mountains stretch across much of Japan, and some are even covered in snow, as you can see here. This one is covered in snow.
This is Mount Fuji, which is Japan's highest mountain, and it's also a volcano. Didn't know that. It's pretty cool, but also kind of scary if you think about it, right? So, we have areas near Japan's coast which are warmer, right? So you have the parts of, you know, with snow, like the mountains. But then you have the parts that are on the coast, and you get more of this type of scenery, like what we're used to here in Miami. So this island is called the Island of Okinawa, right? So here, like I said, you have maybe some mountains in the distance, but for the most part, it's nice, sunny, and very green, and a lot of beaches. So yeah, it's very different climate than the other picture, which is pretty interesting, being that it's the same country and also that it's so small. But anyway, let's move on. Okay, so makake, or monkeys, mukak is how you would pronounce it, as, or monkeys, live in the snowy mountains. To keep warm, they soak in hot springs, right? So if you don't know what hot springs are, guys, it's basically these like pools of water, but they're really hot, and they're kind of like big natural hot tubs. If you've ever been in a hot tub before, you know how it's nice and hot. Well, that is what they like, so they go into those pools, except those pools are very, very hot usually, so they must have some you know, extra protection or something, because if we were to get in those hot springs, we probably would not be, you know, happy. We'd probably be in a lot of pain. But these monkeys are able to do that, so that's what they do in order to keep warm. Especially because where they live, it's always snowing. So they might have, they've probably built a tolerance of some sort, right? Tanukis are small raccoon-like animals, right? These things, they're not necessarily raccoons, but they're kind of close to being a raccoon. But again, they're not. They made their homes in Japan's thick forests, right? So Japan has a ton of thick forests. And they tend to live in there, kind of like our raccoons live, like on the beach where there's a lot of, you know, woods and a lot of trees and stuff. That's where they tend to live, right? Well, since they're similar, they kind of like the same type of environment, so they like a bunch of trees too, guys. And then they're also a sign of good luck in Japan. So if you ever wanted to give someone a good luck charm, you would give them one of these, which is a little tiny statue of a tanuki. Right? And so, like I said, they're a sign of Japan for good luck. And so it's pretty cool, right? All right. People have lived in Japan for thousands of years. Long ago, powerful emperors and shoguns ruled the country. Shoguns were these military leaders that lived way back in the day. They led fierce warriors called samurais in battle. I'm sure you guys have heard of samurais before. The guys with the crazy mask and the big armor and the big sword, right? Like this guy. This guy right here is a samurai, and he's riding a horse, right? A lot of times the generals would ride horses into battle and with a huge spear, right? Getting ready to scare their enemies, which a lot of times they did. And so that's another reason why they had such crazy-looking armor, because they knew it would scare the enemy. Back then, the bigger you looked, the scarier you were, and the bigger and the more powerful they thought you were, right? So shoguns built huge castles. Himeji Castle is one of the oldest, and it dates to 1333. That's the year 1333, about 700 change years ago. So that's pretty crazy if you think about it. So yeah, the castle's been standing for that long. Pretty insane. Alright. So today, most people live in big cities, right? Tokyo is the largest city in Japan. It's also Japan's capital, right? So they made the largest city the capital. People travel from city to city on high-speed trains, and these high-speed trains are called Shinkansen. Shinkansen, right? The trains can go up to 200 miles per hour, right? And That's pretty fast. Think about it. It's like half the speed of a plane. So they go extremely fast. So that's how they get from city to city, and they do this like on a daily basis. So many Japanese families live in traditional homes. So actually, their houses in their culture are very different than ours. A lot of things are very, I guess you can say, symmetrical. And the designs are very simple, but also like call back to their ancient ways of living. So here you have a traditional Japanese house, right? You have like the sliding door frames, and I don't know if you've seen before, but a lot of things are on the floor. Like the beds are on the floor and the tables are on the floor. Nothing is necessarily elevated above the floor. Even if it has legs, they're probably really small. And I don't necessarily know the history behind that or the reasoning for that, but I'm sure it has to do something with like the ancient culture, because most of the time they believed that if you didn't do things a certain way, the gods would punish you, or you would get receive bad luck or an omen or something like that. Something bad would happen to you if you didn't obey these rules, right? So that's probably why they continued to do that for so long. And now they don't. They might not believe that anymore. Maybe some people do, but for the most part, it's just tradition. They only do it because it's something that they've been taught to do for their entire lives, and it's what they want to do. So, as you can see here, we have the inside part. So we have the shoji, which is the sliding paper screens that I just told you about, right? There are doors that open like this, like kind of like if you have a sliding glass door at your house, you open it like this instead of opening the door regularly. But they're paper screens, right? So they're made out of this very thick paper, and it's like a door, and it just slides like right or left. It's called shoji. And then the mats that cover the floor are not just regular like cement or something like that. It's something called tatami. So those are the mats that cover the floor, right? They do that in order to, protect the floor, and it's probably softer. Another thing in Japanese culture, and they might go over this later, but is that they take their shoes off before you go into any house. That's like a tradition. Again, I don't know if there's history behind that, but it's something that a lot of them practice. Okay. Japan also has many modern buildings, right? Obviously, like they want to be able to accommodate for those who want a more modern look. So we have buildings that look like this, and it's very, very interesting looking if you think about it. It kind of looks like their own like traditional style, but made modern. So that's also very interesting. It's like they keep the same format, even though they're moving on. Japan is known for its technology nowadays. Asimo is the name of a robot. It can run, climb stairs, and even play soccer. Okay, it can do all these things, and that's him right there. Right? He can run really fast. He's able to climb over things. I've seen videos of him running and then like jumping over this big thing that's like that tall, and then he can also play soccer, and apparently he's pretty good, right? You can see him dribbling the ball there, and it's pretty insane the way that they can build these things, guys. Okay, this robot can speak. So some Japanese robots look and sound just like real people, and this is an example of that. This is not a real person. I know that even though like you're not here with me right now, because it might look a little more real through the camera, even here, me in person, this looks real. And this is not a real person, which is insane. So she can talk. She can respond to certain questions. She responds differently depending on what you say. Right, so if you say, like, do you want ice cream, she'll say no, but then you say, do you know how to write a few words on a computer, she'll say yes. So she responds differently, right? All right, so the Japanese have many festivals, right? Many, many festivals. I don't know if you've ever seen a movie based in Japan or, like, if you watched an anime or something like that that had to do with Japan, most of the time you'll see festivals of some sort going on because they love to celebrate different things. They're very celebratory with their culture, right? And so when the cherry trees bloom in spring, it's time for the Hanami Festival, right? So these big, if you've never seen them before, they're big pink trees, right? The leaves and the flowers on the trees are pink. So it looks very, very, very beautiful. And so when those finally start to grow, they decide, well, you know, let's have a, you know, some dinner under those trees. And so they go and they have their dinner under their trees. And as you can see, they're doing it right there. It's an annual festival, and people very much enjoy it. And some people go from around the world to go and experience that festival with the people of Japan. So it is very, very popular. The Amon Nebuta is the festival that takes place in summer. It's famous for its giant floats, kind of like our Thanksgiving Day parade, where we have those huge floats like going over New York City. Well, here they have these floats, and they kind of do the same thing. As you can see, they have like an army of people pushing this massive float, right? And so whenever this parade comes, they have a ton of floats, a bunch of people push them. It's an incredible time for them. Okay, in Japan, people speak Japanese, right? And so in other Asian cultures, for instance, in China, they have multiple languages. It's not just Chinese. You know, in China, you have Cantonese, and then you have Mandarin, and I'm sure there's other dialects that exist in there, but it's not just one. And here, in this sense, we have just one language, Japanese. And so, this is how you say, excuse me, in Japanese, sumimasen, right? Sumimasen. That's how you say, excuse me, right? And then this is how you say, see you later. Matane, right? You would say, matane, and that is how you say goodbye in Japanese, okay? So some Japanese words are borrowed from English. For example, the word for backpack in Japanese is actually just bakupaku. Bakupaku is backpack in Japanese. So kind of like how we borrowed words from the French, right? And from like German as well, right? Kindergarten is not an English word technically. But we use it every day or a lot of times in our day or whatever. So just like that, they also have words that they borrowed from our English. So, very cool. Okay, so people of all ages read manga. Manga are Japanese comic books. I'm sure you've seen him before. Omar, if you're watching, I know that you've seen him before. I know you love him. And maybe you guys have seen him as well. In fact, there are cafes in Japan that are just for reading manga, right? Some of you guys may know what anime is, which is those like Japanese cartoons that many of you might think are crazy. But they actually start as a comic book. All like 99% of them start as like a comic book. So those comic books are even more famous than the anime itself. And that's what people love to do in Japan, right? So in Japan, more paper is used to print manga than to make toilet paper. So that's, again, how popular manga is in Japan, okay? All right, let's go on. Okay, so there's lots of tasty food in Japan, right? The most famous is sushi, obviously, right? Everybody knows sushi from being from Japan. And so it's made with raw fish and with sticky rice. Not to be confused with regular rice, because sticky rice is meant to be clumped together, and you can essentially, you know, put a ton of rice together and create a huge ball if you wanted to, you know, because it'll stick together, right? Sushi is usually eaten with thin brown sauce made from soybeans, which we call soy sauce, right? So, as you can see, there's an example of it right there. Some sushi rolls right here. And, yeah, food from Japan is delicious. A popular sport in Japan is sumo wrestling. So, during a match, two huge men slam their bodies together, right? So, what it's trying to say there is that they basically wrestle, right? They wrestle kind of like in our wrestling, except it's a little different because, you know, obviously it looks very, very different. And the rules, I'm sure, are different as well. Yeah, see, the first man to push the other out of the ring wins. In our wrestling, it's the first person to pin down the other person for 10 seconds. But here, they need to push them out of the ring in order to win. So it's pretty different, you know. So Japanese people are also big fans of baseball. Yeah, they love baseball and they tend to play. In fact, I believe there's a pretty famous player he plays in America, if I'm not mistaken, and he's from Japan. So pretty crazy. I don't know too much about baseball, sorry guys, but I'm sure you guys who do like baseball know who he might be, right? All right. So, some fun facts, right? We'll go through these fast so we can be done soon, okay, guys? So, capital city of Japan is Tokyo. Population of Japan, 127 million, right? Main language, Japanese. The main form of currency is yen, okay? If you don't know what yen is, it's just used in a few Asian countries, right? It's just another type of dollar like we have, but so it's a little different. Major religions are Shintoism and Buddhism. Alright, I don't have time to explain both of those right now because there's a lot that goes into them. But there are two different religions that are in Japan. Okay? Nearby countries include China, North Korea, South Korea, and Russia. Okay, all of those are right next door to Japan. And one cool fact, there are more than 5.5 million vending machines in Japan. You can get drinks, books, and even eyeglasses from them. So these vending machines sell like anything. Like you can buy whatever you want. And it's pretty crazy, right? So, you know, like we said, we went through the capital. We discussed the emperors or the shogun, right? The hot springs that the monkeys that live in the mountains love to bathe in. The technology, right, that they're known for, won over the robots. And then we talked about how the Mount Fuji is also a giant volcano, okay? And so, we've basically gone over everything, okay, guys? So with that being said, I will be giving you guys a little assignment to do at home, okay? So if you have printer, or if you just want to look at the page on the computer, it's okay, but I'm going to be sending you guys something, and it's something pretty simple, okay, and you guys will be able to do it at home. Alright guys, so you guys have a great day, and I will see you guys in the next video. Bye everyone!
The objectives for this lesson are to learn about Wassily Kandinsky, to learn about what inspired his work, and to recreate an art piece inspired by Kandinsky. Let's meet Kandinsky.
Maddie! It's not time to practice your saxophone! You said it was art time!
Well, I was looking at art in that book, but there was a funny picture that made me think about music.
Whoa, really? Of music? Da-da, interesting! It looks like a person, but it doesn't remind me of music very much. Oops! Sorry!
That's okay. How did you do that, Dada?
I didn't know I was this good at doing whatever it is I'm doing.
Do you think we can make them different colors? Look at that one, Dada!
Dada, cool!
You were just in the book!
I'm the musical man!
You're making the music turn into colors! How do you do it?
I don't know, but Wassily can tell us! We can even go listen to his paintings!
Listen to his painting? Listen? The artist in the book?
It's Dada! Wow!
Dada, can you take us there to see the artist? So, we must be at Mr. Kandinsky's studio.
Yes, you are. I see my little music friend brought you. I am Wassily Kandinsky.
I'm Maddie.
I'm Dada.
I brought them to meet you.
Welcome, Maddie, and welcome, Dada. I hope the musical man hasn't been too mischievous. But he is very musical, you know. Show them, musical man.
Dada, wow, zow!
Bravo, musical man!
Now, what can I do for my two visitors?
The musical man said you might know why my music turned into red blobs.
Oh, yes. Musical man, let's listen to a painting.
There's nothing on the canvas.
Paintings are musical, too. Ready, musical man? Let's listen to the painting.
Nice colors. A horse with a blue rider on it.
And maybe another horse also with a rider on it.
And there's two people on a bench. Maybe it's a horse race and they're watching it.
Or maybe it's two people riding horses through a park.
Each musical instrument made me think of a different color. Musical man will help us, and I will demonstrate. Do you play music, Matty? Would you like to help?
Yes, please!
No.
Look, Dada! The trumpet makes yellow sounds!
They're all different!
That's exactly right!
The accordion makes blue sounds. The violin makes green sounds. Wow.
And we know the saxophone makes red sounds.
And this horn makes purple.
So the feeling that makes a painting is a lot like the feeling that makes music?
And just like a painting is made up of different colors, a symphony or a song is made up of different musical instruments and notes.
So it can be music that is full of colors, or a painting with all its colors and shapes that is full of music.
That is what I tried to do with some of my paintings. Show them, musical men.
And we hear the colors.
Ooh, fantastic! They're going back into the painting.
It's fun. We're listening to a painting. Thanks, Mr. Kandinsky. Thanks, Musical Man. Thanks for the musical colors.
And the colorful music.
Goodbye, Metty. Goodbye, Dada. Come visit us again soon. Stay out of mischief, Musical Man.
Dada!
Dada!
Dada, yeah!
What do you think, Musical Man?
Very good, little friends!
Hey!
Here with another virtual art lesson for you. Okay, before we get started, we're gonna go on into our stretching and then I'll explain what we're gonna be doing today. Okay, so let's go ahead and stretch to our left. Stretch to your right. Stretch up, down, up, down. One more big one up and down. Give yourself a big hug, squeeze, take a deep breath in, and relax. All right, guys, so for today's lesson, it is Monday, so that means we're going to do an artist spotlight. Our artist spotlight is going to be on an artist named Vasily Kandinsky. Okay, so this artist was known for his use of music in his painting. So he was very inspired by music, and we're going to tie it in with a few lessons this week on music. So we're going to go ahead and collaborate with music class, with CBE. We're all going to be touching base on some musical element. Okay, so Kandinsky was famous for that. He saw colors through music. So anytime he would hear something, it would remind him of a specific color, and then he'd put it on his canvas, and that's what he was famous for. So we're going to go ahead and do a craft that is inspired by Kandinsky. We're also going to incorporate that craft with the season that we're in. Right now we're doing spring activities, Easter activities. So we're going to go ahead and do a Kandinsky tree. Okay, so before we get started, I'm going to show you what materials you're going to be using so that you're ready with them in hand. Okay, you're going to need some construction paper. Okay, some colored paper. You're gonna need some glue, again, whichever your preference. You can use liquid or glue stick. I always prefer this one, it's less messy, but whichever one you have and whichever one you prefer, it's up to you. Okay, you're gonna need a pair of scissors. And then if you are not comfortable cutting out circles on your own, you can go ahead and use a pencil to draw it and then cut it out. And we're gonna be cutting out the silhouette of a tree on a black construction paper. So if you have a white crayon, that'd be super helpful so that you can see the outline and it can help you cut it out. Okay, so I'm gonna show you step by step how to recreate this piece. And as you saw in the video before, he focused a lot on circles, vibrant colors. So we're gonna do that and incorporate that into our tree. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and grab a dark sheet of construction paper. Okay, this is gonna be for the silhouette of my tree. And then I'm gonna grab a light blue one as my background. So this specific one doesn't have a light blue, so I'm gonna use a darker blue. So it's gonna be the sky in the background. I'm gonna place it here. And then I'm gonna grab a green one to start working on the grass, okay? So give me a few minutes so I can go ahead and do the outline of my tree and start working on my grass.
Take 2 minutes to gather your materials.
and emotions that come with certain colors. So even yesterday, Friday, when we did our lesson on Easter egg dyeing, we were talking about our warm colors and how they make us think of the sunshine, summer, and they give us feelings of happiness. So try to think of a song that you want to listen to and then see what colors come to your mind when you listen to that song. So when you do that, you can incorporate that on to your art. So you're going to add that to the branches of your tree. So yeah, I'm just going to finish cutting this silhouette out, and then we're going to start working on our circles. Okay, so most of his work, the colored circles had three per circle. So you're gonna do maybe a large circle, a medium, and a small one. And then we're gonna go ahead and layer those on our art piece. Okay, so start thinking, maybe you want a certain color scheme that you wanna do. Or maybe you just wanna do a rainbow. Totally up to you, this is your piece. That's just inspired by Kandinsky. Okay, so I'm gonna go ahead. I'm almost done cutting out the branch. Then we're gonna glue it on. Then we're gonna take a brief pause so that you guys have time to cut these out as well. Okay, and it's gonna give me time to cut out some circles to add onto our branches. One more branch, and then we're gonna get ready to. Silhouette of my tree. Okay, so here you can still kind of see a little bit of the white outline, so I'm going to use that part to glue so you won't be able to see it. Once I glue it, you'll just be able to see the outline of my tree. Okay, so I'm going to add some glue, and then I'm going to add it onto our piece over here on the easel. Remember, your circles don't all have to be the same size. I actually prefer that you do different sizes to give. Okay, you can either put it in front of your grass, or you can just open up a little pocket behind the grass. Okay, actually I'm gonna cut a little bit off of the bottom just because my tree is a little bit too tall. So I'm gonna cut this off. You can gauge it however you want. Bring this up close to the screen so you can see so far what I have. Okay, so right now on your piece you should have your blue background, your grass, and the silhouette of a tree. Okay, I'm going to demonstrate the first set of circles that I'm going to add to my branches, and then we're going to take another quick break so you guys can cut out more circles, and then we'll join back again so we can start assembling them and putting them together. Alright guys, so for your circles, you can go ahead and cut them directly onto your paper if you feel comfortable doing that, or you can draw them and then cut them up. Okay, so I'm just going to go ahead and grab some colors that I like. Okay, I'm going to use orange for my big circle. Remember, it doesn't have to be a perfect circle. Okay, so I have my orange circle. I'm gonna cut out a purple one that's gonna be slightly smaller. Okay. This one's a little bit smaller than the orange one. Okay, I'm gonna glue it onto the orange one. And then the last color I'm going to layer on top is going to be yellow. So I'll go ahead and cut up a smaller yellow circle and then bring it up to the screen so that you guys can see it. So the middle, the last one is going to be a lot smaller than those two. So that you guys take note of that. Okay, another smaller circle. Alright, we have our yellow circle. Okay, and I'm going to add some glue, and then we'll place that in the center of our other circles. Alright, so I'm going to bring it up close so you guys can see it. The different colors. So we have our orange, purple, yellow. So these are bright, fun colors. They remind me of something fun. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and put some glue, bond glue, and then I'm going to put it on our tree. Alright, you can position it anywhere on your tree. I think I'm going to put it on this branch. So I'm going to take a few minutes to go ahead and cut out more circles of different sizes, and then I'll come back and assemble them for you guys so you guys can see the final product. Take 3 minutes to stretch or to grab a snack while Moscato cuts some more circles. I am back with my finished product. I went ahead and cut some more circles. I'm gonna bring up my piece up close so that you can see it and I can show you guys in more detail just what I did. Okay, so here are all my branches and all my circles of different colors cut up. So I'm gonna explain to you what I did with this one. So if you can see this one, I have my orange, I have my blue, my purple, and my green. So this one's, the majority is made up of secondary colors. So that's your green, your purple, and your orange. Okay, and before you get to the orange, we have our cool colors here, our blue, purple, and green. This one has our warm colors. So we have our yellow, our orange, and our red. That reminds us of summertime, sunlight, okay. Here we have our primary colors, our yellow, our red, and our blue. So remember, we use those three colors to make up all the other colors of the rainbow.
So as you can see, this piece is super colorful and it's inspired by Kandinsky. It has his concept of the colorful circles. And I use colors that were fun and bright, vivid. Okay, so I'm gonna give you guys a chance to go ahead and recreate your own Kandinsky tree. Okay, so have fun with your activity and I can't wait to see it during show and tell for our Zoom meeting. Bye guys. See you next time, guys. Remember to bring your artwork to our next Zoom meeting so that everyone can see just what you've been up to. Can't wait to see. Take the next 10 minutes to complete your tree.
Hey guys! So today we're going to be talking about mouth hygiene and how important it is to be brushing our teeth. So not only should we be brushing our teeth in the morning, we should be brushing our teeth at night, and if you can, in between meals as well. So I went ahead and did a science experiment for you guys so we can get a better idea of what I'm talking about, okay? So what I did was I put an egg in each of these cups and I put water, Coke, and coffee, and I'm gonna empty them, and I'm gonna show you guys what the eggs look like. I have let the eggs sit there for a little bit of time, so let's check it out. So far I have let the eggs sit there for more than 5 hours, and I am gonna go ahead and empty them. Okay guys, so I went ahead and emptied the cups and I put the eggs in here. So the reason we're doing this experiment is because I want the egg to represent our teeth, right? So when we wake up in the morning, we have an opportunity to keep our teeth nice and white, nice and clean. But, you know, obviously, sometimes, let's say we want some Coke. Let's say we get 2 cans of Coke, 3 cans of Coke. Our teeth start looking like this, okay? Let's say we really like coffee, which I'm guilty of. I like coffee, so we drink a lot of coffee and our teeth start staining, you see? This is what we, you know, originally have, and then we put sugar in our teeth, in our mouth. We drink a lot of sugary drinks like juices and things like that, and our teeth start looking like this, okay? So I kind of wanted to show you guys what it looks like. Let me show you. Okay. So it's very important to brush your teeth in between meals so that sugar doesn't stay stuck on your tooth and it continues to grow more bacteria, and that's how cavities are made, right? So I found this really helpful video that we're gonna watch, and it's gonna show you exactly how you should be brushing your teeth.
Hi, this is Dr. Anthony Seminara from Downtown Montreal Dentistry, and today we're gonna learn the proper way to brush your teeth. Now, I know everybody brushes their teeth twice a day, every day, but there is a better method, the method that we dentists use. Let's go take a look. Okay, so first of all, what you don't want to do is scrub your teeth back and forth in an aggressive scrubbing motion. This may seem like you're cleaning your teeth, but in fact what you're doing is perhaps damaging the enamel and damaging the gums of your teeth. So instead, what you want to do is take the brush and tilt it at a 45 degree angle pointing up towards your gums, so the bristles kind of rest at the junction of your gums and your teeth. Once you have it in position, you can make small circles back and forth with the brush, back and forth, so that the head of the brush is moving, but the bristles more or less stay in the same place. With each of these motions, the bristles will get further under your gums and in between your teeth, cleaning out the plaque. And I suggest you do about 10 to 20 circles per section. Once you're done, you take the brush and with an outward sweeping motion, sweep off whatever debris has come out from between your teeth. Sometimes getting in the back of the mouth is a bit of a more difficult area. We have a tendency to want to open really wide, which sometimes can cause your jawbone to block out the brush from reaching those hard to reach back teeth. So instead, try only opening your mouth about halfway and then repeating the same technique on the back teeth. In the front, the way to get the backs of the front teeth is to tilt the brush at another angle, an upward angle, and use the heel of the brush to just kind of sweep out whatever is stuck behind there, like so, and very similarly on the top teeth. Finally, the only place where it's okay to scrub your teeth harder is on the biting surfaces of your teeth. And that's to get off whatever food might be stuck in the grooves of the chewing surfaces of your teeth. Try to brush for 2 minutes Within 2 minutes, it should be very easy to get all of the surfaces of your teeth. And that's it. That's how you brush like a dentist. Thank you. Next, I'm going to show you how much toothpaste you should use. We don't want to put on too much or too little. In fact, an amount of about this much is more than sufficient for the average adult to be brushing their teeth with. I don't know if you can see that. Really about a pea-sized amount. You also want to be sure to be using a soft or ultra-soft toothbrush. That way you have the least chance of causing any damage to your teeth. So that was how to properly brush your teeth like a dentist. Thank you so much for taking the time to watch. Stay tuned for more tips and tricks on how to care for your teeth. Thank you.
Hey guys, so I decided to do my own demonstration of brushing my teeth. I sped up the video so it wouldn't be 2 minutes long, but I am doing what the video says. I'm trying to brush each part of my my teeth, the back of my teeth, the front of my teeth, the middle, and take my time with each side, okay? So I did take 2 minutes doing this. Okay, and I also use floss. So I think we can all agree that we want our teeth to look like this instead of like this, right? If we want our teeth to look like this, like pearly whites, then we need to be drinking a lot more water. We need to be brushing our teeth mornings and nights and in between meals if you can, okay? Maybe if you like Coke, maybe limit it to only one Coke can a day, okay? But it's important to brush our teeth because we want a healthy mouth and we want our mouth to smell good too, right? We want good breath. If we keep drinking Coke and everything else that I mentioned, our teeth are gonna look like this. They're gonna look stained and dirty. And not only are they gonna look bad, they are gonna have cavities, right? Our teeth are gonna be full of bacteria and plaque and all of these things that is a no-no. So let's watch a video of what cavities are.
When a team of archaeologists recently came across some 15,000-year-old human remains, they made an interesting discovery. The teeth of those ancient humans were riddled with holes. Their cavities were caused by the same thing that still plagues us today, specific tiny microbes that live in our mouths. These microbes are with us soon after birth. We typically pick them up as babies from our mother's mouths. And as our teeth erupt, they naturally begin to accumulate communities of bacteria. Depending on what we eat, and specifically how much sugar we consume, certain microbes can overpopulate and cause cavities. Diets high in sugary foods cause an explosion of bacteria called mutans streptococci in our mouths. Like humans, these microorganisms love sugar, using it as a molecular building block and energy source. As they consume it, the bacteria generate byproducts in the form of acids, such as lactic acid. The mutans streptococci are resistant to this acid, but unfortunately, our teeth aren't. While each human tooth is coated in a hardy, protective layer of enamel, it's no match for acid. That degrades the armor over time, leaching away its calcium minerals. Gradually, acid wears down a pathway for bacteria into the tooth's secondary layer called the dentin. Since blood vessels and nerves in our teeth are enclosed deep within, at this stage, the expanding cavity doesn't hurt. But if the damage extends beyond the dentin, the bacterial invasion progresses, causing excruciating pain as the nerves become exposed. Without treatment, the whole tooth may become infected and require removal, all due to those sugar-loving bacteria. The more sugar our food contains, the more our teeth are put at risk. Those cavemen would hardly have indulged in sugary treats, however. So what caused their cavities? In meat-heavy diets, there would have been a low risk of cavities developing, because lean meat contains very little sugar. But that's not all our early human ancestors ate. Cavemen would also have consumed root vegetables, nuts, and grains, all of which contain carbohydrates. When exposed to enzymes in the saliva, carbohydrates get broken down into simpler sugars, which can become the fodder for those ravenous mouth bacteria. So while ancient humans did eat less sugar compared to us, their teeth were still exposed to sugars. That doesn't mean they were unable to treat their cavities, though. Archaeological remains show that about 14,000 years ago, humans were already using sharpened flint to remove bits of rotten teeth. Ancient humans even made rudimentary drills to smooth out the rough holes left behind, and beeswax to plug cavities, like modern-day fillings. Today, we have much more sophisticated techniques and tools, which is fortunate because we also need to contend with our more damaging, sugar-guzzling ways. After the Industrial Revolution, the human incidence of cavities surged because suddenly we had technological advances that made refined sugar cheaper and accessible. Today, an incredible 92% of American adults have had cavities in their teeth. Some people are more susceptible to cavities due to genes that may cause certain weaknesses, like softer enamel. But for most, high sugar consumption is to blame. However, we have developed other ways of minimizing cavities besides reducing our intake of sugar and starch. In most toothpastes and many water supplies, we use tiny amounts of fluoride. That strengthens teeth and encourages the growth of enamel crystals that build up a tooth's defenses against acid. When cavities do develop, we use tooth fillings to fill and close off the infected area, preventing them from getting worse. The best way to avoid a cavity is still cutting down on sugar intake and practicing good oral hygiene to get rid of the bacteria and their food sources. That includes regular toothbrushing, flossing, and avoiding sugary, starchy, and sticky foods that cling to your teeth between meals. Gradually, the population of sugar-loving microbes in your mouth will decline. Unlike the cavemen of yesteryear, today we have the knowledge required to avert a cavity calamity. We just need to use it.
Okay guys, so for the next activity, we are gonna go over together what pictures belong in which column, okay? So what we're gonna do first is read each sentence, and that will help us decide what pictures go into which column. So let's start with the first one, okay? Eat healthy foods. Which picture do you think goes in eat healthy foods? What are healthy foods? If you guessed this one, you're right. We're gonna put healthy foods right here because that's carrots, looks like potato. Is that an onion? I'm not sure, but I know this is a carrot, so that makes it a healthy food. Okay, so the next one is go to the dentist. Yes, this is a picture because he's at the dentist, right? You can see it, here you go. I'm gonna put that right here. The next picture is brush teeth twice a day, which is the brushing of the teeth, that's twice a day. So it would be this one, okay? Floss every day. Where's the floss? All right, good job. All right. So unhealthy things. Eating hard candy. Where's the hard candy? Would be this, a mint, right? It's very unhealthy. Drink sugary drinks, like what we talked about, right? Soda, let's put soda under there. Chew on non-food items. Oh, looks like I got this one wrong. This one goes here because he's chewing on a pencil maybe, not sure. Okay, so I guess I'm gonna put the brush here. And then the last but not least is eating sticky candy. So this looks really good, right? But it's very unhealthy for our teeth. So this gives you guys an idea, okay, of what to avoid, right? Try to stay away from sodas, okay? Because we don't want our teeth to look like that. And, you know, mints or caramel apples. We have to make sure that we're brushing our teeth and eating healthy and making sure we go to the dentist so they can check out our teeth, right? And flossing. So this worksheet is going to be available for you guys if you want to print it out. You're welcome to, or if not, then you guys can just do a journal, okay? I want you guys to write down some things you're going to focus on each day that you wake up, especially now that we're home. Sometimes we just forget to brush our teeth, you know? So I want you guys to write down something that you've learned, something that you'll do different, okay? So now I challenge you guys to remember to be brushing your teeth for 2 minutes every morning, 2 minutes every night, maybe playing a song that's 2 minutes every time you brush your teeth to remember to know how long that you should be brushing your teeth, right? Don't forget to floss too if you have mouthwash, that'll be helpful. We wanna make sure that we're taking care of everything that's going on in our mouth, right? We don't want cavities, we don't want bacteria just hanging out there camping, right? We don't want to go back to the dentist and them telling us that we should be doing more, okay? You guys can do it, right? So that's what I want to challenge you guys with, and I'll see you guys next time.
How you doing, guys? Today we're gonna go over wants and needs. Last time we went over budget and some of the hard things that are that we need to distinguish between wants and needs is sometimes they're a little difficult to understand that actually some wants are actually needs and vice versa. Okay, so we're gonna go over today on the next sheet of paper that I'm gonna post up, which is wants versus needs, okay? And on this page, you're gonna see a list. It's page 2. So you're gonna see a list of different wants and needs. If you look at the list, right, you start off with food. So food is actually a want and a need at the same time. But what kind of food is a want? Can anybody Think about it for a few minutes. What kind of food is a want? I'll give you an example. Let's say an ice cream. An ice cream is a want. You don't necessarily need to have an ice cream. What's a need for food? Think about it for a few seconds there. A need is a breakfast, lunch, dinner. Could be rice, could be steak, could be chicken, could be healthy foods, correct? All right, let's go over the next. Computer, that's a tough one, a want or a need. Some of us need it, some of us want it, but for the most part, it would be a want, because if you wanted to use a computer, you can go to the library, you can go to the Wow Center, or you can go to a friend, but most definitely you can go to the library. All right, and there we go, ice cream. What's ice cream, a want or a need? Okay, I think that's a want. Look at cupcake. Okay, what kind of, what is that, a want or a need, a cupcake? Exactly, a cupcake is a want. Potato chips, a want or a need? Potato chips is a want. Water is a want or a need? Do you need water? Everybody needs water, right, to survive? So yes, water would be a need. A house. Okay, yes, you need a roof over your head, right? So it could be a house, an apartment, a condo, a townhouse. Okay, so house is a need. Shampoo. What's shampoo? Do you need to clean your hair all the time? Do you need to stay hot with a good hygiene? Yes, so shampoo is a want. No, it's a need. Exactly. All right, so shampoo is a need. Clothes. Is it a want or a need? Well, that falls in the middle, right? But for the most part, it's a need. You'd have to have clothes. Vegetables. Well, that should be a need as well. But for some people, it's just a want, or they just don't like it at all and they eat something different instead of vegetables. All right, but a vegetable should be a need. Next, fruits, right? Most people like fruits, some type of fruits. Some people like grapes, some people like watermelon. So what's that, a want or a need? Okay. Candy, that's easy, right? We don't even have to go too far on that. Candy is a want. You don't need to have candy. Electricity, that's important, right? We need electricity for the internet. We need electricity for TV. We need electricity for, when you take a shower and get nice hot warm water. Okay, so you need electricity for many things. So that is definitely a need. Internet. Okay, that's a want. You don't have to have internet. You don't really have to have it, because that ties in with what other thing that we said right up top. Computer, right? That ties in with computer. So computer, internet, that all comes together, as well as cable. Those are all wants, right? At times we may need them because we're used to, you know, being online. We're used to having the World Wide Web in front of us, because we get that either at work, or we have that at school or at the Wow Center. But that's really a want, okay? So internet, cable, trash bags. That's a need. You need to put things in the trash so they don't go all over the place and we keep everything recycled, correct? Okay. Let's go to the next one, which is lemonade. Lemonade. Do you need lemonade or do you want lemonade? That's a want. Soda, that one's easy. We don't have to go too far as well. And that's a want, right? Have water again. which we know that's a need. Soap, right, for good hygiene, stay nice and clean. Soap, we need soap, that's a need. Video games, I know what your answer is going to be on this one, but video games is a want. A want. Okay, good. TV, that is also a want. Vacation, it's a want and a need, right? Sometimes we need a little vacation to get nice and fresh again and come back and do it all over again, right? But it's a want. You have to, you know, save up for a vacation and be ready for one, right? So it's a need. It's technically a need, okay? Machine, washing machine. So, what do you think about that? That's a want. You know, you can go to the dry cleaner. You can go to a laundromat. There's other ways of getting your clothes washed. But it's a want that eventually you want to need too, right? Okay, movie, that's a want. That's simple, right? Cell phone, that's a want. But then again, it's a need nowadays, right? Because we don't have phones at home. For most part, we have our phones that come with us. So that's why we need a little job in order to have a cell phone. A car is a want. It's not really a need, right? Because there's other ways of transportation. There's STS, there's Uber, there's the bus, and so on, all right? And the last one is shoes. Want or a need? This is a need. We need shoes to walk around, right? All right, great. All right, so take a look at this for a couple seconds more. Then we're going to switch over to the next sheet, okay? Next sheet. The next sheet is also wants versus needs, but this one has like drink, food, clothes, shoes, shelter, transportation, hygiene, utilities. And when you look at the sheet, what it wants us to do is to give us examples of things that we actually need from each category, right? That's why I was saying, well, yeah, we need shoes, but what kind of shoes? We need food, but what kind of food? We need drinks, but what kind of drinks? Right? We need a shelter. What type of shelter do we have? So there's different options for a different budget that we all have, correct? All right. So let's look at number one. So we got under drink. We see lemonade, soda, water, juice, and milk. We were going to Publix, or we were going shopping. What would be the most important thing to buy when we would go and pick our drink? Would it be soda? Would it be water? Milk, juice, lemonade? I would say most of you guys are hopefully saying what? Water. After water, milk. After milk, either juice or lemonade. And we don't have to buy soda at all, right? Okay, good. Next, food. All right, so like I was saying, here we got food. We had vegetables before, we had fruit before, didn't say cookies, candy bars, and meat. So we need meat, because that's protein. So we gotta make good choices, right? We need meat. It could be chicken, doesn't have to be red meat. Vegetables, it's gotta be some type of vegetables. Everybody's gotta like spinach or carrots, right? Candy bars, we don't need them, but it's nice to have a candy bar here and there. So that's not a real need, okay? So you can have then your fruits, right? So you got, according to your budget, you know, you're gonna buy your meat, you're gonna buy some veggies, you're going to buy some fruits and then say, well, okay, I'm going to buy some either candy bars this time or cookies, but I'm not going to buy them both, right? All right, good. Let's go to the next one, clothes. All right, this is a big one, right? Because we all shop at different places and we're all looking for the nicest shoes, the nicest clothes in order to look good, right? And feel that we have something nice on. So if you go to the Gap, right? That's one price. If you go to Walmart, that's another price. If you go to Marshall's, that's another price. If you go to American Eagle shirts, it's another price. And if you go to Macy's, you got another price. So you have to learn how to shop, right? Depending on your budget, depending on your check, you're going to say, well, I'm going to go ahead and this week, since I made a little extra money, I may go to Macy's and shop because it seems like the middle of all the prices, right? Or this weekend you say, you know what? I want to be a little conservative. I want to be frugal. I want to save some money, buy things that are inexpensive. I'm going to go to Marshall's or Walmart. Okay. So if you look at the paper, right, it gives you a little idea of what you're going to spend according to your budget, right, and to your wants and needs. Shoes, Payless, Nike shoes, Air Jordan, Walmart shoes, DSW clearance shoes. So it all depends your budget, like I said, or if you're buying yourself a Christmas gift, or you're buying yourself a gift, or you want to have that special, you know, shoes that are really comfortable and you really want them, then, you know, you go ahead and try Nike shoes or buy some Air Jordans. But if you want to go to work and you want to maintain and have a nice little budget for work, you may want to go to DSW, which is like the middle ground of the shoes here, right? There's DSWs right around the corner from most of us, okay? We're not going there now, but you can still order online. If you order directly from Air Jordan, you know, you're gonna pay pretty expensive shoes. Walmart, you got good price. Nike shoes are a little expensive. And Payless, which I think there's no more Payless. They were pretty cheap too, okay? Shelter, apartment, a mansion, a house, a castle, a cabin, okay? It all depends on your budget. If you live in an apartment, if you live in a mansion, if you live in a house, a castle, a cabin, okay? So that's all according to your budget and goals as well. Transportation, a Kia car, a Porsche, a Ford, a Lamborghini, a Dodge, STS, okay? Transportation, for most of us are using STS, right? We're using STS or our parents are taking us. Or we're using Uber, okay? Or public transportation. Great. All right, hygiene next. Very important, hygiene, correct? Perfume, soap, body wash, shampoo, toothpaste. I think all of these are needs, right? You need to have body wash. We know we need to have soap now more than ever. We need shampoo. We need toothpaste always, right? And we need a little perfume to smell good, correct? So I think in hygiene department, I think all of those are needs. Next, utilities. Internet, cable, electricity, water, and phone. You need water to take a shower. So you can use your body wash, right? And you can get into your transportation and go, you know, out or go to the community or just stay home for now, right? You need electricity so you can have warm water. You don't want to be in cold, freezing water and have to take a shower like that. So you need electricity. So those two are number one. You need a phone, right, for emergency or for any type of services that you may need. So that's important. And then that's where the want comes in, internet and cable. Those are the two wants, right? So that's where we have to figure out, you know, our budget, if we can afford this internet and cable. Now, sometimes you can get away with just having internet and getting going on, you know, different websites and different channels to be able to get just straight live internet TV, correct? All right, guys, so today we went over wants versus needs. Last time we worked on a budget. I'm going to be going around and giving you guys the budget section that I want you guys to fill out, and also the wants versus needs section that I want you guys to fill out. So you'll be receiving a phone call from me, and at that point we'll see how we're going to meet and what's the best way. Speak to your mom and dad, speak to you, group home manager. I'm going to see you on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. But you'll be receiving a phone call from me next week. Have a great day. See you next week. Bye.
Hello, guys. Carlos here, technology teacher. Today, I have the privilege to be with you and share with you week number 3 of special topics, which is community integration. But first, if we want to talk about community, we have to understand what is a community. I have a definition here for you, so you can read it or hear it with me. Community is a group of people living in the same place or having a particular characteristic in common. So examples of communities are the family, neighborhoods, workplaces, churches, and among others. Now that we know what community is, let's jump to the questions. And I have question number 1. Am I part of the community? I'll give you 1 minute to think about it, and we'll keep discussing. Am I part of my community? Well, there is different ways we can get involved with our communities. Being part of a community is a powerful experience. Communities give us home, friendship, warmth, and a sense of belonging. But how can we really be part of our local community, guys? There is many ways to do it. You can get to know your neighbors or give your time to others, or just get active in different activities to maximize your own involvement within your community. I know we're not going to the WOW Center right now, but when the WOW is open, we have a special class named CBE, or Community-Based Education, which is the class that takes us out in the community and give us the opportunity to get more involved within our own community, by knowing new places or new people or just get a new experience, maybe in a place that we didn't know that exists. And what are your CVE teachers? Do you remember their names? Okay, let's see. We have Susie and Stephanie, and that's CVE2. And CVE1, it's Teresa and Stephanie. Yes, we have two teachers named Stephanie. Don't forget that, guys. Okay, ready for question number two? Let's go. Okay, question number two. Are you happy with how much involvement do you have in your community? Once again, 1 minute to think about it. How much we are involved in our community depends on us. If we are able to go out and do. You don't need to do big things. Small things also count, like getting out the garbage or cleaning your front yard or helping some neighbors in loading their shoppings. Small things also are good things. Now, can you think about other things you can do to gain more involvement in your community? Question number three, am I an active and contributing member of my community? Think about it, 60 seconds. You can contribute in your community in many ways, such as volunteering, internships, when you go to work, or church, or action club for those who are in it. At the end, no matter how you get involved, the important thing is to get involved, to participate, to contribute, and be an active member of your local community. So now I know we're going through a special situation. Now, if we are in a quarantine time right now and we cannot leave our houses for security, of course, maybe your question is, how can I be part of the community if I don't have any relationship with many people at this time? That's a good question. Well, maybe you do not leave your home. You don't see your neighbors, or maybe you're not going to your work. And definitely, we are not attending to the WOW Center since it's closed. But we can still be part of the community. Doing what? Well, respecting the law. The quarantine was enforced for our security. So you, your family, and your neighbors can keep healthy. And little by little, we can get rid of this illness which is going around the world right now. So now, how can we be part of the community in this moment? Well, staying at your house, respecting the quarantine, and also listen to your families and to your caregivers. Being part of the community also involves to keep the community safe. And respecting the quarantine is how we do it right now. Guys, it was amazing to be with you. I hope you enjoyed this and have a great day. Bye.